Greetings and welcome to RLM TV.
Welcome back. It's good to have you.
God is good to Israel, and the angels are all Israelis. Hallelujah. Mm-hmm. Let's see how many people can focus on the message tonight instead of my clean-shavenness.
Isn't that cute?
Stay focused now. The Lord said my Nazirite vow was finished, and I had several signs and wonders saying, it's time to be clean shaven.
Oh yeah, the nefesh is usually distracted by the different external stuff, isn't it? You know, one of the things I thought was so fun, so funny when we were going through Barnabas, the epistle of Barnabas, was how it was so clear to Jesus, and as he taught his disciples, it became so clear to them that this whole Old Testament time, God wasn't even really talking about the food they were eating. It wasn't even about that, but they could only carnally interpret it. And so all, like, basically all the Jewish laws they had were just their carnal misinterpretation of what God was actually saying. And I thought that was hilarious. And but it's kind of like, you know, God lets people kind of just like, all right, well, we're gonna learn it this way. And it's just, it's so wild. You gotta check out Epistle of Barnabas.
Yeah. Yeah,
we like the Christopher Glenn has a nice channel. I feel like a nice reading. It's really soothing. Mm. Nice graphics. Easy to read words. Read along. Put some background music of your own on, and just have a great Bible time in the Word together. You know, with your family, or you know, with your angels who are family, who are Israeli.
Yeah, that's Hebrews 12:22. There is no angel that serves Jesus Christ except the angels of heavenly Jerusalem. Zion, it says, Hebrews 12:22, which means they're all Jewish angels. Mm-hmm. Any angel that's of the 70 nations of any other ethnicity is a demon. That's the Tower of Babel. That's Babylon the Great. Mm-hmm. That's when he scattered them and gave them 70 principalities because they wanted to serve demons, building a ladder of the kelapot, of the husk, instead of the circumcision group of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, which are our patriarchs. If we're circumcised of heart, you are the children of Abraham, Galatians says. So in these days, we're separating sands from rocks. And these aren't rocks like the Himalayas. These aren't rocks like Mount Shasta. These aren't rocks like earthly rocks. These are the solid rock that is Christ the ladder, Christ the stairway. His cross goes up forever. If I be lifted up, I will draw all men to myself. Well, you don't lift him up on the sand. Matthew chapter 7, in Jesus Christ's gospel, sand building, sand teaching, sand castles, sand clothing is forbidden. It's forbidden. And in all Jewish theology, in every single study of every scholar of all time, the sand and the dust always equates to the earth. So we have 2,000-year-old doctrine that forbids any earthly building. But when you think that's all there is, you end up like a shadow of the Apostle Paul standing on a sand dune instead of Almighty Mashiach and Moses on the ladder, which is Zion, right? Revelation 15, I saw all the overcomers standing with Moses and the Lord Jesus Christ singing the song of Moses, okay, Torah. The song of Torah, the spirit of Torah, the wisdom of Torah, and Mashiach. And everyone else is down in the sand. Guys, the goat's head battering ram, that's all they're going to get. So now God is commanding repentance, get to the ladder, get those nations, demons that are pretending to be Jesus and Christianity and sound doctrine off of you. That's the kelapot, the husk. The judgment fire is only for the husk. Underneath the husk, The husk is the mark of the beast. The husk is the mark of Cain. The husk is the mark of Esau. The uncircumcised husk is the mark of all hell, and hell's dominion was given the dust or the dirt or the sands of the earth. That's God the Father speaking to the serpent in the Garden of Eden if you read the Bible. You can't have that and be in heaven. You can't have that and be a successful Christian. You'll be an uncircumcised Christian until you get the husk of the sands of the earth off of the born-again part of you and complete the whole circumcision of your heart and your mind on the ladder, which is the genetics of God the Father. Everyone knows that ladders symbolize DNA. You can go to any elementary school in America, any junior high in America, and what is the picture of DNA strands in every high school in America and every nation on earth? They'll show you a ladder. In the description, it says a ladder. So we know the ladder is the very God sperm genetics of God the Father and the Almighty Mashiach, Jesus Christ of Nazareth, who came in the flesh. Why flesh? Because it is a DNA ladder. It's a recoding of your hearts. If you don't cling to your old 70 nations, including Jewish nations, husks, and you allow that to be cut off your hearts and cut off your minds by the angels of the God I am, whom I serve, you will prosper exceedingly during these days. These will be the best days of all life of all time. If you're anti-husk, if you're clinging to the husk and you have sand clothing, sand Christianity, you have sand Jewishness, and you have sand doctrines and sand coverings, sand governments and sand finances. This is the most miserable, torturous time to ever be alive. Jesus Christ said it's not easy kicking against the pricks. What's the prick? He's talking about that which circumcises the husks. That's a sharp goad that keeps the donkey moving forward. That's the goads. It's not easy kicking against the goads. Or the tools of circumcision that keep the inner man in alignment with what God the Father is doing. Another sharp rebuke that you guys need, because the Lord Jesus Christ told me to tell you, you need to stop appraising and applauding sand leadership. Half of that's Kelopot committed crime. Okay, we have all these people down here now that are just sand leaders. I don't care how good you think their teaching is, how good you think their prophesying is, or praying, or their outward appearance of being pious and Christian. I don't care if they're Orthodox. I don't care if they're unorthodox. I don't care if they're Australian or Assyrian or the bishop that was just stabbed by a terrorist or anything like that. You cannot praise people in the sand. That is not a martyr, and that is not a display of Jesus. The display of Jesus is not in the sand. Don't be set up by the Kelopot to praise the principalities who orchestrate chaos and magic, disconnecting people from the ladder. The Lord Jesus said, these people in their ignorance are praising the principality Pan today when they think that that bishop in Australia that was attacked by a Muslim terrorist is a martyr, and that he really suffered for Jesus, and he's praying for the Muslim man that tried to stab him right afterwards, and that's a good example of Jesus Christ. No one in the sand is a good example of Jesus Christ. You are actually honoring and giving the energy of your blood to the principality of Pan, says the Lord. Now let that really touch some of your hearts to reveal how much you serve the husk. Serving the husk, guys, is the serving of the fallen angels. And the greatest deception of all time is pretending that the husk is godly. And that's what we need to get rid of. That's what's holding you back. That's what false love is. If you can understand the difference between the husk of sand in all of its forms of goodness, piousness, religiosity, even self-sacrifice. If I throw myself into the fire but have not sapphire stones, God is love, I make myself a false martyr. False martyrs get applauded by Christians a lot more than those who teach from the sapphire stones. Mm-hmm. You guys are still worshiping the devil.
I have something to say about that.
Truth anyhow.
A lot of stuff that you see pushed around, like news articles, online posts that get really popular, viral things, a lot of that is Klippith Nefesh energy harvesting. And we had a nice picture the other day about how that works. It's not just, you know, personal. It's not just personal ministry that's used by Klippith to drain the life out of your blood. If you're not an angel assignment, guess what? You're giving away your blood to the blood-sucking demons. in well-meaning people. That's how it is. Not one is good. But what we also find is that when they have all of these, what do you want to call them? Clippeth planned news stories that get blasted all around, and you know, you don't want to give your energy to those kinds of things. Like, you know, one of the warning signs of the husks, and our cosmic students know this already, they can tell you when anything is very a strong emotion reaction to something that's posted online, whether it's very positive or very negative, high likelihood that you're being clipped. High likelihood that something's trying to garner energy from your ruah, from your neshama, God forbid. You know, from your nefesh, that light that's in your nefesh. Because the life is in the blood, the nefesh is in the blood, and that's your vitality. So stop giving your vitality away to demons. How many times I gotta tell you?
It's a circus show down there.
Yeah.
They want you watching and praising anything in the sand.
Or even being really upset about something. They trigger.
Yeah.
You know, to be, indignified.
I'm with Whoopi Goldberg. I'm with Candace Owens. I'm a rhinoceros. I'm an elephant. I'm a donkey. I'm red. But as long as it's sand, you're worshiping the fallen angels with your blood. You need to get to the ladder.
And then you notice, then everyone is like, then like they're trying to get populations of large groups of people hyper-focused on some news event. And they're like, look, who's this thing? Ooh. And yes, it's a thing, but it's in the sand. And so what does it do? It takes all of your focus away from circumcising the rung that you're on to actually do something in the world to change it and raise the standard like Noah. And then all of a sudden you're like thinking about this other stuff going on, and then you're getting... That's the sheeple cycle of, you know, the Illuminati control, the 13 crown family of the wicked Kelopot and the earth, just trying to get you distracted from what you should actually be doing.
Totally.
So it's not a bad thing. You don't have to be paranoid. Paranoia is a demon.
Off. Move on.
So just, you know, rebuke the spirits of paranoia and fear and worry and all that thing that try to like take all your focus. Because remember, it's the holy focus that unfolds and unrolls the Torah scroll inside you when you have holy focus. It's like getting into that flow state. Have you ever worked on something and focused for so long that you went into a flow state? You unlocked a new dimension of understanding. Have you ever been a student studying for hours and you just kept pushing through studying, like for a physics class or science class or an English essay? This book just, it was too much old English and it was hard to understand it. You just like, this looks like it's like another language, but you persisted and you kept just going at it until all of a sudden something clicks and then it unlocks and then it opens up and now you're in that flow state. You're having fun. Or like when you, it works like this, when you go to your job and everyone's clipping and they're like, it's so slow. How many hours we got left? Oh, great. Did you see who walked in? Oh, you know, here comes the blah, blah, blah. Our boss is coming in today. Oh, they're coming this week. We just have so much to do. That's clipping. You're getting clipped. All that stuff. Oh, I can't wait to go home. What a long day. But when you know, this is the job that the Lord has given me, I'll rejoice and be glad in it. And why am I here? I'm here for a purpose, because I know this is the place where God put me. Then you start to work under the Lord until you get into that flow state. And you fight against the clipping in your own mind, in your own heart. And you stop thinking like, I can't wait to be done with my shift. There's a shift in you. When you work unto the Lord and you abandon all your nefesh plans of, well, what if I don't get to go home early and somebody else gets to go home early? And I've got so much Netflix to watch tonight. Wah, you know, like you get into this flow state of abandoning your own nefesh desires to wanna, I just wanna recline at home and watch TV and make my little thing and do my little stuff. And then you put all of yourself into your work. And you start to care about each person that your client, people you're serving, the people, you know, you're working there. You change your mind. Everybody else might have the old mindset, but you don't. You can pick up the extra shifts. You can work the longer hours. If you get to go early for the day, you rejoice in it, but you don't need it. You're not thinking about it. You don't think like that anymore. Why? Well, what am I going to do anyway? Because you don't. Your old life is already obliterated, so there's nothing else to do. You see what I'm saying? And that changes the whole game. That's when you shift into that flow state. There's no problem coming in that you can't solve because you got the Holy Ghost living inside of you. You're abandoned from your self life. Sure, can I close down the place tonight? Of course I can. Of course I can do it. Can you learn how to do this and this and that? Of course I can. You know, I know you just got here and you showed up, but everything's gone to crap. Can you jump in and just start helping everybody else, even though there's zero financial benefit to you? Other than the Lord is pleased with you.
Developing his character in you.
That's
which is the greatest financial benefit.
Exactly.
Come on.
That's the training. That's why we go to jobs and that's what we do. I know, because that's what I did. You gotta get it. It's not about all the things people think it's about. Or like, let's say, let's do one for the homemakers, you know, one for the family people. You could already think everything is perfect, or I might be trying, let's make it easier, because it's easier if you could find something wrong about me than about somebody else, maybe. So let's say I'm going to be a homemaker, and I don't have any Jedi Council stuff to do. So, you know, I want to do nice things around the house or something, you know. If I just would go around fault finding and cleaning up after family with a sense of fault finding or with a sense of negativity or paranoia, I would have been better off if I'd never even picked up a dustpan. Would have been better just to leave scattered trash around the house, like rose petals. Trash, 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 and all, like. Why? Because you're spewing trash. When it's demonic filth, it's still filth.
Creating an atmosphere of sin.
That's the thing is, I could clean this whole place perfectly.
But like, if it's like a husk nest for demons when you're in that external attitude of all the fallen angels.
Oh, I can't believe he scuffed the floors with the blah.
Your heart creates an atmosphere of heaven or hell, depending on circumcision or uncircumcision.
So if I had never even been bothered and never cleaned up, if it would have been more meritorious for me than if I had cleaned up after family and then made a demonic mess everywhere in the invisible realm, pretending like it's not real. Look what a good job I did. And I'm like, bro, there's feces everywhere in the invisible realm.
Rub it into your family members so that you get your praises from men instead of
God.
Look
what a good job I did for you.
Because the husk is the essence of unbelief.
Yeah. So then, well, now you got demons pissing all over the house and you want, good job. Because externally it looks clean. That is the worst thing you can do. That is the self-righteous abomination. Like, people who have an actual dirty house have more righteousness than that. So remember, natural realm and invisible realm, we want them to match.
One of the main messages of the Almighty Mashiach, Jesus Christ of Nazareth, was anti-hypocrisy. We've all read it thousands of times. The hypocrite, when you're in the husk, it seems to always be someone else that disagrees with your husk. Well, you're the biggest hypocrite. That's the plank in the eye pointing out the speck in someone else. What's plank in the eye? Practicing the foreskin and membrane of the husk of Adam and Eve instead of Almighty Mashiach underneath. Hello? The circumcision of heart reveals the messianic nature underneath. That's the only part of you that's not a total raging hypocrite and wrong about everything. Now, since it's smaller than the heart and the brain, it often gets overridden by the heart, feelings, emotions mm-hmm. of the husk, and the brain of thoughts and intellect and reasoning mm-hmm. of the bigger part of you, which is the flesh. So in order to be a disciple, a member of the Talmudim, which is the first step towards salvation after receiving Jesus Christ, he said, mm-hmm. then become disciples, then make disciples, Talmudim of nations. Only after your Talmudim can you ever become the Zedekim. Now that's the mm-hmm. Hebrew gospel of real Christianity. Apostle Barnabas says, do not pretend like you are already righteous and you separate yourself like Enoch with the angels after 234 years of being King of Kings and Lord of Lords, mm-hmm. according to the book of Jasher, which means Enoch himself had 234 years as the Talmudim. He was with the people ruling as king. Then he became Zedekim and separated himself from the people, it is written, to be with the angels. First Enoch, it is written. So understand that same exact pattern exists mm-hmm. in Hebrew Christianity of the first century. You don't see anything different. So that is the pattern we need today if we want the restoration of all things. All this other stuff is just Greek and Hebrew wannabe demons and Jewish demons, Greek demons, Roman demons. It's all demons. It's all sand demons, and that's all serpent food according to Torah. Therefore, to come out of the demons and out of the sand, we have to get into solid rock teaching, sit under solid rock teaching, become students of teachers of the solid rock, and then become disciples of the solid rock after we acknowledge what the cost really is to go to war against our own husk. And when you go to war against your own husk, the husks of all similarity around you will begin to rage on you. That's why the members of your own household will be your enemies, Jesus Christ mm. said in the gospel, right? Okay. We don't like those parts of the gospel in American Christianity, but somebody type in the comments, truth anyhow. Mm-hmm. When you begin to count the cost of going to war against your own husk, mm-hmm. your own Adamic and evil nature, your evil nature in your heart, in your mind, in your soul, in your bones, in your marrow, and you begin to change the ladder from Satan, which is original sin, to Jesus Christ through circumcision of the heart and allow it to be obliterated by the Holy Spirit and the angels out of you. Everything around you of what hell has built in sandcastles begins to turn on you because you have turned against the husk. The husk is the kelipot. Yeah. When you study kelipot or klippeth, the word klippeth means husk. So when Jesus Christ says, I'm coming to burn with judgment fire the wood, hay, and stubble. Oh, how I wish I had already been blazing in fire. He is talking about the klippeth and the husk. John the Baptist and Jesus Christ had one enemy. This is the enemy of Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, guys. We need real Christianity. Listen to me. This enemy is the husk alone, the kelipot, the klippeth. And it begins with you waging war against it in your own spirit, in your own heart, and in your own mind, and in your bones and marrow. It's an internal angelic war, and it's a word war to see whose words you'll agree with, mm-hmm. the so-or-so seed. So what kind of seed do you think the fallen angels are going to come and sow? Husk seed, the seeds of husks. Mm-hmm. Okay, the seeds of the kelipot are all the Belial, is the fathering of religious lies, self-righteous mm-hmm. lies. And this
looks
is why
good, no fruit inside.
You must discern the sand. If you can't tell the difference between sand and solid rock today, you'll let any old angel sow seed into you. You'll let any teacher, you'll let any prophet, you know, this is an established prophet in the glory stream. Well, if they're on sand, they're lying to you. That's the standard of Jesus Christ. Maybe your whole denomination is about to burn. You better come out of it and stand on sapphire stone. God's not going to tolerate the human nature any longer. The husk is set for slaughter in all dimensions and all rungs for this timeline, so that none of this should be a surprise to any of you. It is written, when the judgment fire comes against the uncircumcision of the foreskin and membrane, the husk, the kelipot, and the klippeth, it should only promote you instead of destroy you, because you've already received his sword and loved his word and married his word to remove the foreskins of your heart. Jeremiah 4:4, it is written. But if you haven't removed the foreskins from your heart and the foreskins from your mind and the foreskins from your bones and marrow, this judgment will feel as severe as it does against the demons themselves.
Mm-hmm. Amen. That's the evidence of self-righteousness, which is the default fallen human settings. So I want to touch on two of those topics here. I want you to write this in the comments here, because this is a highlight. The Lord's addressing, you know, the home and family life for some of our people watching here, just to shine the light, because whatever the light of Tiferet touches, that's, you know, the light is the truth. Mm. As, you know, Tiferet also represents truth, because it says mm-hmm. God has given truth to Jacob, to Israel, Tiferet. And so this is a Holy Ghost highlight here. So I want you to write this down. Cleaning up after family members while thinking negative thoughts about them or having negative feelings about them is making a mess. So go ahead and write that in the comments. Cleaning up after family members while thinking negative thoughts about them or having negative feelings toward them is making a mess. So if it's self-righteousness, if you're externally cleaning your house, good work. But on the inside, you're thinking negatively toward the people that you're cleaning up after. You're feeling negativity toward them. That's called making a mess. So then on the outside, your nefesh might be happy that now it's clean. I did a good job. But in the invisible realm, if angels are face palming and shaking their heads, now they got to clean up after you.
True.
And that's the self-righteous hypocrisy. And here's the thing, it's common to everybody. So you might feel like, oh, you know, are you reading my mail today? Or I feel targeted or whatever. Or, you know, this is common human activity. But it's working unrighteousness and wickedness in the home. But the simple thing is, if you're just aware of it and you want to change your way to agree with God's way, you're going towards a sapphire pavement, going to the cave of treasures, you can simply just notice that inclination to evil. The next time you go to pick up after the kids or after, you know, your husband or your wife, and as soon as you notice any negativity toward them or a judgment or a thought that's condemning toward them, oh gosh, this is blah, 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 you know, whatever, negativity, just repent inwardly and be grateful to be a humble servant of Yahweh. Who are you really doing this for? And also be kind toward the angels, even if you're having trouble not being negative towards your family members, and just work on that repentance, at least for the sake of the angels who are gonna have to clean up after you. You know,
the sensitivity to the holy angels is the sensitivity to the Holy Spirit. Yeah. You can't have holy angels without the Holy Spirit, or the Holy Spirit without the holy angels. The gospel says the glory of the holy angels is the glory of the Holy Spirit.
They're whacking me right now.
So when you say grieve not, resist not, and quench not the Holy Spirit, you're saying grieve not, quench not, and resist not the holy angels synonymously.
Yeah. You should fear to offend heaven. Mm. I fear to offend the angels with us. It's like, imagine you have an ambassador, a dignitary of a foreign nation coming to your house. You would be afraid to say something to hurt their culture. Their human nefesh culture. Everyone watching right now, don't think it wouldn't be us or it wouldn't be you. We would feel that immediately. Like, this is the Prince of Nigeria. Ooh, man. It's funny. But we would immediately feel it. They would come in with all their fancy, like, different culture. And we would be so careful not to offend them. Like, hey, what's that thing you got on your head there? You know, no, you wouldn't say that. Like, why are you dressed like that? Why? Because any healthy relationship comes with a healthy amount of fear. Hmm. You just don't say that. Why? Because you care. You're any, even by nefesh, decent human being standards, which we know is total self-righteousness, even by nefesh standards, you don't do that. Like, people who act in that way are considered, like, subhuman even by nefesh.
Barbarians.
Yeah. So, you know, we don't want to dip into, like, subhuman activity, you know, descending in further into the cowpot. But we would be, you know, there's certain things we just wouldn't say. Or they speak a certain way if they have a funny accent. Someone comes in with the most hilarious accent that you've only seen in comedy movies, and it's like, you hold your breath. You're like, I'm not going to laugh.
You deal often with an irreverent joker, you know? Spirit, which is one of the main principalities holding all Christians back, that you just mock everything and just make light of everything because you serve the devil, joker spirit, under the Jezebel tower, and you haven't made hardly any progress to the Cave of Treasures at all because of that joker principality you serve, that you just mock everything higher than you, mock everything more holy than you, and you just have all these doctrines of demons that you think is freedom, and it's just serving the joker spirit. So that joker spirit, you want to make sure you repent of that, because in the prophetic church, you see that joker thing going around everywhere, and that Jezebel witch going around everywhere, wanting to prophesy for some kind of reason, or to speak inspiration, or pretended to be inspired for something that's not Christ crucified to death, that's not for the ladder, that has no eternal value of the sapphire stones of building on the solid rock. That's the evidence of all the Joker and all the Jezebel, which are the two main principalities holding back all charismatic Christians on earth from coming into the heavens and building on the solid rock in these days. So understand, you must repent of joking and jesting and making light of everything holier than you. I mean, people jest and joke about obedience. They jest and joke about holiness. And they say, I'm already holy and I'm already obedient. Where? In your own imagination? To your foreskin and membrane? To your own nationality and the blood and the angels of your nation? I mean, what reverence is there?
Or you're like, I already have my house perfectly in order and clean. And your angels are like, please,
well,
stop.
Well, see, if Samael comes and tests you, is he going to find husks in you?
That's
Mashiach said, Samael, Satan is coming, Garden of Gethsemane, but he has no husks in me. And so when Samael came into the Garden of Gethsemane, the Bible says that he was inspected by the fallen angels to see if he was a spotless lamb. And they checked all the boxes. So before all the fallen angels who have no accusation against Jesus Christ of Nazareth, because he was inspected by them. Now, Christians don't like to be inspected by anyone because we're so self-righteous and self-defensive of everything and my little ducks in a row. Listen, man, you have to be inspected. Otherwise, I mean, there's just no Christianity in you at all. It's just delusionment. And you don't need that in these days. You need to be protected and safe.
Yeah.
The main thing apostolic leadership from this ministry is trying to do is get you safe. Safety first. And if you don't understand how to get safe, it's going to take a change in your heart and a change in your mind to get into the realm of safety. You might fight safety. You know, safety also means to be saved. Salvation means safety in every single case from Genesis to Revelation. So are you really safe from the fallen angels if they were to come and inspect husks in your hearts and minds? Repent, get that stuff out of you. The word of God's already upon you to cut it off. Why are you clinging to the husk? There's no excuse before God and his angels. The instructions have been given to everyone for thousands of years, hundreds of years, generation upon generation of prophets that have told you the truth. We have the wisdom of the ages. We have the Holy Spirit. You have the teaching. Now all we need is true repentance.
Amen. I like that. You can put that in the comments. Safety first.
Amen. True repentance.
Salvation. So this is what I wanted to say on the fear of heaven is known by rabbinical sages of old that it's really, really, really important. Like, you know, there are gates of the fear of heaven, which is greater wisdom and understanding. We talked about human nefesh dignitaries. If we're all in a room and then, you know, someone, let's say like a dignitary, you know, we're talking about like a prince of Nigeria or something, comes in with their ambassadors, and there's a certain way you would have reverence toward nefesh. And then if you were in the Joker spirit, like, I don't have reverence toward Nefesh. Right. And then you're just being even worse than everyone who's at least being decent.
Now you go to jail like a false martyr because you disrespected the natural law that's for jokers like you.
Yeah.
Are you going to serve the law of Jesus, or are you going to serve the natural law of the husk? For the law of both realms, the living law and the dead law, are for sinners. And it will deal with everything unto perfection in the coming hour.
And so you'll see, we'll have like dignitaries from heaven that come around here. And so what'll happen is there'll be like a really important angel from heaven that'll be around. And we've had instances of this. And, you know, there's some that permanently come and will dwell with us for whatever their assignment is in our time and on the earth here. And what it's like that, you know, when that new angel shows up, or that, like, let's say a group of angels, like when we went to New York and we met, they're so organized and they're so thorough and they're so charismatic, but like just so razor sharp. Like,
that was like a festival there at the airport. Yeah. That was one of the wildest things when those New York angels visited
us. They're so professional. They're so like, it was like, you can tell they've been wild around,
man.
Yeah. And they were so wild, but they were strong, they were organized and charismatic. I mean, they were just like, they knew everything that was going on in the block, the whole situation in the entire city, and give it in a condensed report in an organized and orderly fashion, but being concise at the same time to, you know, the captain of the host of New York City. And, you know, giving our head of the angels, you know, kind of the download, and this is how what we have, we prepared for your arrival, and here is the basically, you know, everything
is organized.
Angelic
itinerary.
Yeah.
Forget man's plans.
Yeah. Why about go with what he said? We're just going to go with what he says.
You got to get cabaled. Otherwise, you're doomed. Sand doomed.
But I felt that fear. You know, when people, like, let's say, versus, like, you know, the president of a country or a prince of Nigeria coming around, and then we're, you know, we have a fear, a healthy fear. Every true love relationship has a healthy amount of fear.
Amen.
Otherwise, it's not love. You know, that's just how it is.
Oh, but sister, there's no fear in love. The reverential fear of the Lord, buckwheat, you blasphemer.
So I noticed myself wanting to be on my best behavior to not make, not just to not make myself look bad. I don't want to be a bad example of the latter, because if, you know, I don't want to make the engravings of the emanations of Yahweh Vave and his ladder be despised in any way or look bad to the angels, God forbid. You know, that's his name. He like put his name there, and so it's a serious thing. But at the same time, like, I also want my angels, our angels, I was thinking, like, I want to be on my best behavior so my angels look good, like, wow, y'all are doing a good job keeping them, keeping that nefesh, you know, they're staying in their higher soul. Well, like, I wanted their angels in New York who are looking all shiny and stuff. They don't have to deal with us every day. Like, the angels around us have to deal with us every day. The nitty-gritty and, like, the weird. Oh,
they're so lucky.
I was like, I'm going to try and be on my best behavior and make you guys look really
we're
good.
So lucky. Amen.
So it's little things. It's the little things like that. But I just remember not wanting to embarrass my angels in front of the other angels.
Amen.
Not that, I don't know, would they be embarrassed? It's just, it's
I'm
respect.
Sure my angel did some hooliganism. We got some wild people here.
Making our angels look good ministries, somebody says in the comments. That's fun. And so then we'll have like a really important angel come around somewhere. And then I'll try to be, I notice that it puts the fear of God in me because I'm aware of the presence of the angels. And there's just certain ones I want to be, like, how I act towards Brandon and my, like, my thoughts and my words, because the angels hear your thoughts.
Yeah.
So you want to be, like, really sharp, you know? You're, like, you're
and
always...
Your thoughts are your interaction with the angelic world.
Yeah.
Your thoughts are not just invisible to you and in your own little nefesh, you know, husk thing. No, your thoughts are the manifestations of your spirit interacting with the invisible spirit world.
Mm-hmm.
Purify your thoughts, you purify relationship with angels.
Yeah, so many worlds ago, like in the past, we would have these different experiences and these crazy, like, high and holy angels would show up and we would feel it, you know, and just be like, whoa. And for that time, in that lower level of immaturity, we would be cabaled into a higher way. But, you know, due to our, you know, our limitations and our immaturity and just our thoughts and our words and actions, even though you're just trying your best, it's not up to the standard of those angels. So they would literally, they would just leave, right? Mm. We would act a certain way, just like in our dumb nefesh, and just living in that lower level of thinking and acting and speaking, yep. you know, toward each other and toward others, and just thinking we're fine. Mm. And those higher angels, they would leave. They will straight up leave.
Yep, I've witnessed that.
And then I'm like crying, like, oh, I'm sorry.
Reminds me when we had the sun come into the old crack house. Mm-hmm. It's no longer the crack house. From now on, let us refer to it as the Ovadiah house. Because mm-hmm. they're coming out of Edom to be prophets of the spirit of Elijah in these days. So we were in the crack house and we're sitting there. The sun comes down and begins speaking through the seer prophet. And then he says, God's got a word for you. You're going to have a shiny ministry, Brandon. He looks at me and he looks up. Seven stars, like suns, came down and descended and ascended upon my head. Seven archangels. Mm-hmm. And I was so sad that they ascended after they descended. Even though I could see them and feel them, and the seer could see them and feel them, seven suns, like seven stars, the seven archangels of the kingdom of Jesus Christ, came in and descended on my head, but they ascended. You know, I haven't been able to interact with them until I got on the ladder. When I was in the sand, they never came back. And it was about a year and a half later, when I finally got to jump out of the sands of time onto the rock of ages, the eternity of eternities, on the sapphire stones, and begin to work with these seven suns and seven archangels, the seven stars in Jesus Christ's right hand.
Amen.
Amen.
And so we're learning the angelic ways and just how to behave and how to think and act and feel. It's a different culture. You know, seventh heaven, true Araboth of, like, you know, like 100, what, close to 100 weeks of ascension or something like that. Whatever it is, 70 to 100, however many weeks of ascension that is. The requirements to be there and live there, it's totally different, and it's not like something you just memorize it or you try to think it, you struggle. When you go up the ladder, you struggle, you wrestle with that rung, and you get it circumcised. Mm-hmm. And then you get those permanent breakthroughs. And then you're a different type of person. And then you go to the next rung, and it's just everyone, it changes.
The sapphire stones emit the thoughts of the Father.
Yeah.
Oh my goodness. So your heart is filled. When your heart gets circumcised, that first tiferet of Isaiah, it's your first chance to feel through your emotions what the Father's truly feeling. He is the sapphire stone pavement. This is our eternal resting place as Israel. Over the sands of time, there will be no more time after we're done. We'll have the eternal Sabbath day's rest, for this is the seventh day.
Amen. And you notice God has a wide variety of emotions. He's not like a dead and dumb, like carved idol or a piece of wood or a piece of stone that only has one expression. Mm-hmm. Right? He's not just a stoic, angry God. You know, if they carved a big frowny face. He's not just some, like, you know, a happy, dumb God. They just carved a joker smiley face into it. And his God's just always smiling. No, he's not. Nope. You can't tell him what to do. He's God. You can't tell him how to feel. Are you kidding me?
He's a plethora of emotions.
Like, God's never offended by all the horrible things I do that's offensive to heaven. What? Are you kidding me?
No, he is sometimes.
When the angels are offended and they leave, you know?
Yeah.
Well, angel flash over here.
Amen.
Oh, wow. And there goes again. Yeah, like a shooting star. Yeah, like he's like demonstrating, like I'll dip out like this. Exactly. See? Mm. Yeah, he's sorry. He's like, he came back. he's just messing with me.
The angels of all the nations. These are all the Jewish angels of Israel.
But I'm doing the example here he showed, like, you know, they shoot off like a shooting star sometimes, some of these, like when they're offended and leave. So he's demonstrating this is what it looked like. Shoot off like a rocket, like a shooting star. And then bam, he flashed, came right back. But just like, yeah, exactly. That's what they do when they're offended. Psh, then they go. Why? Because heaven's not going to be around that. Now, the beautiful thing about your two guardian angels that are with you from birth is that no matter how bad or offensive you are, they stay with you. Unless you start selling your actual inner man. You remember the inner man spirit of light we talked about? Your five senses of your flesh? is not your true self. That's the part of you that needs to be put to death through the word of God. Through the engaging in the light of the word of God, letting it cut the flesh. Because those who lose their life, they find it. But those who, you find the new life, you lose the old life. That's what you do. The new life is a new creature, which is your inner spirit man, that part of you that's made up of Shekinah light that God knit together in your mother's womb. That most of us, we didn't learn how to grow. No one fed our spirit. Yeah, angels over here. No one fed our spirit for the most part when we were kids. Or some people did, but it was usually it's fewer and farther in between.
Mostly
and you don't
just
learn how to feed
husk.
It. Yeah.
Living in the shadows.
Mm-hmm. So you want your Bible time to outweigh your Taco Bell time, so otherwise we're just not feeding the body and starving the ruah, the soul, or the innermost being, and not even just your ruah. There, your where you're consciously aware.
Your pneuma.
Yeah, it's like
your spirit,
your eternal self. Now you might be asking, which soul is my eternal self? Is it my ruah? Is it my neshama? Is it my chaya? Is it my red rose soul? Here's the mystery. Here's part of the mystery as we're allowed to talk about. And it'll become clearer to you as you go up, because the Shema is the seven, and it's the seven and the seven. It's being married to God. But the eternal part of you, those souls are the possibility of the heights of stature for you to grow as an eternal spirit. And those souls are like their garments, understanding the layers and how God has many layers to him. And so you're made in his image, and it's your potential of upward growth and development. How high can you grow? How many of those, hewn from a higher substance or from the rock higher than you, are you going to build up the temple, which is what you are? You're the temple. Right, we're the temple of God. Your body is a temple. What body? Invisible sapphire stone body. He's building a better temple.
Amen.
And so how high and how tall are we building that? Like a righteous palm. Righteous palms, cedars of Lebanon. There's heights. How tall is, priest Michael, Archangel Michael? He's, about seven heavens tall. Angelically accurately, he's about seven heavens tall.
120 weeks.
Yeah, and I believe, so I may or may not remember the exact measurement of it, but I believe if you're passing in your physical body to walk the distance, it's 500 years per to walk about the size of one wing of an archangel from that level. So if you were just to walk from the size of one wing to the other, it would take you 500 years or so. And so
not on the path of lightning. On the path of lightning, it's as quick as a holy thought. Bam.
Yep. And so we can't do it in the nefesh. We find we've got to get to the ladder.
Amen.
And use the invisible part of us, because the carnality of fallen sinful flesh
and
cannot
please God. Once you get to
God.
The ladder, guys, the main thing that will oppose you is the fivefold that are true fivefold but still in the sand. Now, this is true. Listen to me now. The main thing you wrestle from the ladder of sapphire stones as an apostle on the sapphire stone eternal ladder of the law of God the Father and all the angels, the main thing fighting our gospel of sapphire stones are the true fivefold down in the sands of time. They know they're called, they're chosen, they've been set apart, they even fast and they pray, they even purify their heart, they don't practice sexual morality, they try to be good and holy people. Guys, is that any different than the Exodus of Moses? You had all of that same exact holy activity, sanctification activity with Moses' Exodus. The issue wasn't that you are Israel, you are Christian, you're believers in Jesus Christ, you're leaders of tribes, you're leaders of families, you're leaders of nations. I mean, that was not the issue. The issue was, are you on the sand with the golden image or on the mountain of sapphire stones with Moses? That is the only thing that matters in your minds. Understand that according to the Bible and you'll be safe. Amen.
Amen. Yeah, they ate the bread of angels, so if they ate bread of angels and didn't enter in the promised land, we can't just automatically assume things about heaven and about what God wants to do. We're supposed to find out what God's perfect will is, But, you know, it's really hard to hear when we're really emotional. You know, that's when communications are gone haywire. Good luck, you know, because, you know, we can be really accurate. We can be really accurate and really, you know, razor sharp. But when it comes to things that are very emotional, we just can't even hear because we're just too emotional about it.
And the blockage from hearing is having your human blood there instead of the blood of Jesus that speaks a better word than the human being.
Yep. So it's good. We need the peace of God, and we need the righteousness and the purity of God, and we need the joy of God. But remember, the joy should come after the purity, righteousness, and peace. Otherwise, you're stealing joy, illegal joy, which comes from clippeth demons. Yeah. So, and also peace. Stolen clippeth demon peace. Like, you know, fallen archangel peace. You know, fallen angel Molech peace. He has the appearance of peace, but it's not Jesus Christ peace. Jesus said, the peace I give to you. Right? The peace Jesus gives to us is different than the peace that Molech looks like he has. Why? You know, if you're just comparing exterior shells, Molech looks like he has a lot more peace and patience than Satan. And he makes Satan look like a little angry crybaby.
That's true.
And, you know, just the reality of the situation is all their stuff is stolen. You know, Jesus Christ has peace and patience. Mm. Jesus Christ has the righteous indignation and anger. So when you see the husks imitating him in that way, you know, when like Satan loses his temper, it's not the same as when Jesus is flipping tables. When Molech, you know, would bide his time in peace and patience, demonic patience and peace, it's not Jesus Christ's peace. Mm-mm. So when Jesus said, here's the peace that I give to you, it's not the peace that the world gives.
Woo.
So you can't just judge your own fruit of your own heart, because we can't know our own heart. We need to get cabaled by our holy angels and by, you know, the words of the apostles, so that we can let those things shred the human nature, because the husks of the fallen human nature, which is the dust of the earth, which is the serpent food for the other side, that's what has to get obliterated out of our hearts, so that we're not operating in Satan's kingdom or influenced by Satan's kingdom. And so we're finding that you can say, well, I have peace, I have joy. Well, okay, well.
All right, well, let's see when Samael comes, if there's a husk there.
Who has more?
Well, yeah, what they're going to do is you're going to test everyone to see if there's husks or no husks. You get tested every level. You get tested in the sand. You get tested on each sapphire stone. Mm-hmm. If you pass those tests, like Jesus in Gethsemane, guess what? You just get promoted. Mm-hmm. You just get absolutely prospered by God, because now you're an Israelite, a tested Israelite. Mm-hmm. Everyone, Abraham, Isaac, Jacob, 12 patriarchs, Joseph, best example out of all of them, continuously tested, and guess what? Passed. Yeah. Passed their tests of being tested in this world by all the fallen angels and all the wicked men and women around them constantly. It is no different for any of us in these days. We must pass our test by the removal of the husk, by receiving the sword of the Spirit, the word of God that obliterates it.
Amen.
Amen.
That's so good. It feels good to get the clippeth out and off.
Amen. And heaven just is simply a husk-free zone.
Amen. Unless your peace surpasses that of the fallen angels, how are you going to be a disciple? So when we have our own peace that's not Jesus Christ's peace, it's not possible for you to have a higher clippeth peace than top of the clippeth. You see what I'm saying here?
Yeah.
It has to be, you know, your joy might look like a lot in your own eyes compared to someone who's circumcising their heart and is in travailing of soul. But your joy, your clippeth joy, will never exceed your clippeth fallen angel father's.
Truth.
So when they come around, they annihilate you. As you're annihilating, as you've annihilated and murdered your brother and sister, judging them for like, why don't you have any joy?
Where's
and they're
your,
just
where's
like,
your freedom?
And they're like in the ninth
week. You're getting
week,
religious.
And they're in like ninth week, 10th week, obliteration.
One serves a reptile and the other one's serving the spirit of the living God. Get a life.
Amen. And so that's why Jesus made it a point, like, don't judge your master's servant. So someone may have just, you don't know what people go through in life. You really don't. unless God reveals it to you, you're a prophet, or you have a gift, and God reveals the revelation to you. Some people, you may see them having a good time and laughing, but you don't know that, you know, that sister in Christ or that brother in Christ, they went through horrific trauma, traumatizing things that you might, if you went through what they went through, you might not even be a Christian anymore.
Yeah.
And so you just don't know. And then when you see them, God has really blessed them with an overabundance of wine and joy, like the medication of the glory, and they're just happy all the time. Don't be envious, don't be jealous, don't be having evil eye toward them, because you don't know what they went through. They don't have to tell you that part of their testimony. That's not their job. You can't judge your master's servant, lest you be judged. So when you see them enjoying, like, why are they so happy all the time? You know, I can't stand it.
You know, this is an attribute of being a Jew. You know, in the Moses' Exodus, one of the commandments of Torah is that you are not envious of your fellow Israelites. If you were envious and had an evil eye towards them, Torah says you are no longer a Jew or an Israelite. How much more today in Christianity? If you have negative emotions towards brothers and sisters, negative thoughts, negative reactions, an evil eye towards other believers in Jesus Christ, the truth is, according to the scriptures, you are not even a Christian at all. You're a Satanist practicing Balaam's evil eye. So you got most people out here pretending to be Christians. They're not Christians. They're Balaams. Yeah. You can't be a bigger Satanist than a Balaam, which is practicing the evil eye in the guise of the circumcision, because even wicked Balaam had external circumcision, but his heart was hell itself.
So clean hearts, clean hands, pure minds, pure hearts, lest Joseph be your accuser in the heavenly witness, because you know, you don't want to say, well, this person hurt me, if they hadn't said this or done this, and it's their fault. No, it's not, you know, because Joseph, even though his brothers tried to kill him and sell him and all this other stuff, he didn't hold it against them. He got past the bitterness and he forgave them. And he loved them. And he never blamed them for any of his problems.
He got really over the husk. I mean, so really over the husk that he didn't even acknowledge it anymore.
So over the husk that the Egyptians said, this is the firstborn son of God.
That's right. You know? Jasher.
While the son is in him, you know.
And his brothers continued to try to kill him and plot to kill him a couple more times.
That smells like delicious casserole.
Even in Egypt.
It smells like a delicious casserole. This is a feast. This is delicious. I like this.
Understanding the wisdom of the ages.
This is amazing. I like this. Tastes good.
Very good.
It's good spiritual food. I'm enjoying the overflow here.
Really, becoming your brother's keeper. And not just a keeper in the sand, but a keeper on the solid sapphire stones.
Yeah.
And even if you haven't merited Yasad of Asaya yet, you're making progress there, and that's what counts. That you're making progress towards the cave of treasures of our patriarchs and our holy Jewish angels to serve God on the ladder. Amen.
Amen. That's just healthy and holy all the way around. God's will, his ways. And we're receiving through the holy angels that he has assigned to us. So let's, you know, begin right now at home to receive the help of your holy angels. And here it is. Thank you. I just got the angel reminder. Again, they're always helping, always reminding. This is an activation, just a very quick activation for you. All right, all right. All right, so pay attention here. This is your angel activation. Okay, man. Yeah. This is, okay, here's the activation. So it's the impartation just in the word here, so you can receive it. All of our experiences, we put them in word form here, and then you receive that, and that's an activation. Don't give it to the brain or, you know, the heart or how you feel. Just put it in your spirit. And receive, be activated here. So there was a mystery that had been boggling my mind for probably, I mean, who knows? It's been months. Mystery of the kingdom. Mysteries and secrets of the kingdom. And I needed this to be made clear in order to carry out my mitzvah. And no matter how many times I'd looked at it, thought about it, done the research, I couldn't figure it out. Couldn't figure it out. And I didn't want to just go with my best guess. We can't do that around here. It's either, you know, 100% solid rock, sapphire, stone, or I can't, like, put it together, really, to release it unless I have this confirmation and certainty and a knowing, like, what the class, this course is built on is solid rock of sapphire stone. It's not just like a little revelation and I'm pretty sure it's right. Whew. It's tested and tried. Eternal. And confirmed, yeah. And so I couldn't figure this mystery out for like months. Excuse me. And then I look over my shoulder, I look over the angels next to us, and I just start talking to them out loud. Yes. I'm working on this project here. And, you know, this is why it's not like me just wanting to know cool stuff for, you know, my own entertainment. Although entertainment is one of the heavens.
Yeah.
There's a whole heavens that's basically called all about entertainment. And entertaining the Holy Ghost, I heard one of them say.
Amen.
Yeah. So I asked them, you know, look, this is what I've been working on. I know this one and this one and this one, but these, I don't know. And I need it all to tie, like, to know which one is which, what's what. And of course I went on the Hebrew so that we can understand the angelic requirement, a little bit about the culture, angel culture, Mashiach, Yeshua, Messiah, Jesus. So that we can really know that way it's not just, you know, in our own language, which has its limitations. Just to really, it's needed for my mitzvah to complete, you know, this thing that I'm working on for our people, so that people who are learning and growing in the ladder will be able to know the culture of the angels at these levels. Mm-hmm. Hey, angels.
I watch you. You put in at least 80-hour work weeks since we've been gone for 5 months.
Mm-hmm. It's been really good.
People probably don't realize that. They think we're on vacation or something. I watch your work harder, like 80 hours a week to advance God's kingdom through all kinds of stuff people can't even fathom.
Yeah, and then they give a
code, writing code. I mean, just awesome increases for God's kingdom.
Yeah, you know, this is. I guess we'll get additional extra impartations for free. It's burning now. The only code I'd ever knew was you copy and paste to your MySpace, like in the early 2000s. I don't even know what it is. You know, just click the little box. And you know what? My background of my MySpace was red roses. Anyway, that's, where's my MySpace page? There you go. And have a nice day.
Yeah. 12 hours a day, 7 days a week. It's like there's no off switch for a real apostle, especially one on the ladder that is obliterating the husks of the sands of time. I mean, this is awesome, you guys. God is doing a great reformation in these days, and we're thankful that you're a part of it. Be activated.
Yeah. So, two parts here. The bonus edition here was, I didn't know how to do this thing, but I needed to get a piece of coding together to make something work so that, you know, our app could do something for you, right? Which is why? So that others can learn righteousness and go up the ladder, right? So we could make it accessible to others. And I just didn't know how to do it. And then I got angelic help, and then God gave me a dream. And in the dream, I saw how the coding works in like this picture form. I was in the sanctuary. And in the sanctuary, it looked like these, like a three-part video game, but it was how the coding worked. And so then when I woke up from the dream, I was finally able to implement this code to do this little thing. And again, not just being like an expert or anything, just boom, boom,
dreams
boom.
About coding.
Dreams about coding. And then it made sense when I woke up. And then I was like, oh, amen. And then we were able to do it.
Awesome.
And it's God's provision, because we're not out here just like, you know, it's not for whatever. When everything that you do in your job is for the kingdom of God, which is the service of others, then, you know, the heavens of God, the kingdom of God, they answer, they help, they're bringing help. So there's the extra bonus impartation there. And that can apply to anything. Maybe it's something you just don't know how to do. And you need something that you don't know how to do what you need to do to complete your mitzvah. And so heaven is being released to help you do that mitzvah, because it's about helping others get to the ladder. That's what we do. That's why when we go to our job, we refine our soul so we can get to the ladder first. And then you can help somebody else get to the ladder. Mm-hmm. You can always help by liking and sharing and subscribing and, you know, clicking to get the notifications. You know, I notice since I get the notifications on my phone for our YouTube shorts and channels, my angels will actually use the Holy Ghost highlights. So go ahead and sign up for all the, click on the bell and get the all notifications. Like for me, do you think, like, you know, we're creating content, even though I don't watch every single, you know, additional clip that we've already talked about, there'll be a highlighted one. So then I'll click on the highlighted one. But how are you going to see the highlight? You know, you're opening the door for the holy angels to cabal you with instruction. So just making yourself available in that way, there's highlights.
Yeah, be proud of your leaders on Sapphire Stones. These men and women have overcome the world. The ones you should not be proud of anyone on the sand, they haven't overcame nothing. And we need that reality check to just shake the nations right now, because the mind is focused on all kinds of worthless things. The enemy is creating events. Now, one of the things you need to understand in these times to be safe is that the kelopot, the husk, and the angels of the husk, which are all demons, create and orchestrate all events in that realm of dominion. That's called hell. They'll do it in politics. They'll do it in classrooms. They'll do it in religion. They'll do it everywhere there's husks. It's Mr. Smith maintaining his matrix. Satan and his angels were given that by God. So understand that now. So nothing of the husk of the sand or the seven mountains of Esau distract you. Let your focus be on the ladder and keep repenting further from the realm of created chaos of the husk. It'll be chaos in your family, chaos in the marketplace, chaos all around you. 1,000 will fall by your side, 10,000 by your right hand, but it shall not touch you. Why Psalms 91? Because you're in with the circumcised Jews on Israel's ladder called Jacob, Jesus Christ, Almighty Mashiach. Genesis 28, John 1, 51. Amen. And that's when you're solid in the eternity of eternities and nothing of the enemy's kingdom can touch you at all.
Amen. And the second part there, which is the main impartation activation, is asking your angels for help. Mm. So separate from that little code, the blessing there, that I was stuck on something, I didn't really know how to do it. You don't want to hire someone just to do some little thing, you know, and have it answered. And so, you know, when I was stuck on a revelatory item that needed to be scribed so that we can have it to help other people to meet the requirements and righteousness as they go up to those levels. And I asked, I explained to the angels, I literally just turn and look at them because I can kind of see their, you know, their forms sometimes will appear a little bit in the lights, you know, they're always flashing the lights to us in response to the
Urim and the Thummim. Yeah. It's the lights of the angels in the new covenant.
Mm-hmm. Amen. And sometimes we'll see like their wings or them moving around. And there's a little area they usually stand around us, at least like there's like, it's the little gallery there of them. They're hanging out.
That's so awesome.
And I just look over them. I straight up open my mouth and just started talking to them. And so I'm glad I have a spiritual husband who doesn't mind, like, all right, just talking to the invisible people again. Time to throw them in the loony bin. No, you know.
You're talking literally into the ephod of Almighty God with angelic response, like lights every single sentence.
Yeah. They're light up. So it's good counsel. And I just asked him, like, you know, I'm just stuck on this part. The reason, you know, I need this information is so that we can be, this is for the class. This is so that we can meet the expectation of our father and to understand the culture and what does it mean? Because in the Hebrew, it's going to tell us, you know, with the Kabbalah and the Sapphire stones, we're going to learn about what that is. And then everyone who comes up, and they'll be able to conform more readily to that culture. We want the angelic culture. And so this is a key part of this in, you know, our maps and all this stuff. And so literally what took me months and I could never get it, one night completely filled out all the information. I made a little spreadsheet that had all the different data points that I wanted and requested, and it's all filled out.
Amen.
And within one night. And that's the activation. So receive that. Mm. If you're not sure, ask your angels for help. And I didn't just sit there and listen. I did sit and quietly listen a little bit until I could hear, like, where to look, what to study, where to find it. And is this right? And then I had to break through some kind of confusion of, like, red magic, because these things are secrets that are, you know, have been stolen from the by, you know, the enemy. And they try to put confusion around different items.
Just a little sand.
Yeah. Yeah. And so, you know, when you're going in to pillage those things and get that back for the kingdom, you're just breaking through your own ways of thinking with the angelic help, with the Kabbalah, with the holy sapphire stones. And so what that does is it judges all the enemy stuff. But at the same time, it brought clarity, and it was just like, it was just astonishing to my mind to see how things had been, like, hidden, concealed, or just, it was wild. But what was more astonishing than that was to see how much heaven's help came through for us every time that we ask heaven for help, and it's with that pure intention, 7-Eleven, and it's that holy intention of, this is for the saints, this is for the body of Christ, to build them up into maturity. And also so that we can meet the standard. We want to be like you guys. Like, we want to be like them. We want to think like they do. We want to act like they do.
Heavenly Jerusalem, city of angels, you will obey the angelic instruction to develop the angelic part of you. If anyone's in Christ, they're a new creature. The word there is the same for angelic creature around us throne, the living creatures. So that angelic part of you, that's the born again divine part of you, God is spirit. Those who worship God must worship in spirit and truth, John 4:24. That part of you is what gets kabbaled. And by obeying mitzvahs from your heart, your spirit part of you, it develops the angelic dimension. And that's what removes the husks.
Amen. That's a nice activation.
Boom.
Amen. That's good. So much good stuff tonight. Yeah. You guys are having an amazing, you know, beginning of early of the week here.
Oh, it's just the first day of the broadcast of the week. It feels like a Saturday tonight,
doesn't
it? Yeah, it
does. Yeah, it feels like Shabbat.
This is only Tuesday.
Woo! I think we're starting to step into that eternal Shabbat.
Amen.
Which is nice. So, which is the glory of the 80-hour work week. The Shabbat rest is the glory of the 80-hour work week. Somebody put that in the comments, because that'll break someone's...
The Shabbat rest is the glory of the 80-hour work week. Boom.
My father is always working.
My father is always working.
When you love what you do, you never work a day in your life, which is what? What do you love doing? His, working unto Yahweh. His commandments. And his commandments are what?
Not burdensome. Easy and light.
Amen.
God bless you guys. Thanks for watching tonight. We'll see you tomorrow.
Amen.
Ladies and gentlemen, esteemed guests and beloved supporters, today I stand before you with a heart filled with gratitude and a vision illuminated by faith. We are gathered here not just as individuals, but as a collective force with a shared purpose, to extend a hand of abundance, to bring forth prosperity, and to manifest the heavenly realities in our world. As we embark on this journey together, I am reminded of the words of Proverbs 3, 9, and 10, which says, "Honor the Lord with your wealth, with the first fruits of all your crops. Then your barns will be filled to overflowing, and your vats will brim over with new wine." It is through our acts of honoring and abundance that we have the opportunity to make a tangible difference in the lives of those around us. RLM TV's missions are not confined by geographical boundaries. From the bustling streets of Florida to the sprawling landscapes of America, from the vibrant city of Nairobi, Kenya, to the farthest reaches of the globe, our mission knows no limits.
We are driven by a commitment to serve, a commitment rooted in the teachings of Matthew 6:33, where it is proclaimed, "Seek first his kingdom and his righteousness, and all these things will be given to you as well." With your support, we have the power to manifest abundance, to uplift communities, to sow seeds of prosperity that will yield a harvest of blessings for generations to come. Your generosity is not merely a financial transaction, it is an investment in the heaven of our world. In the book of Malachi 3:10, we are reminded that, "Bring the whole tithe into the storehouse, that there may be food in my house. Test me in this, says the Lord Almighty, and see if I will not throw open the floodgates of heaven and pour out so much blessing that there will be not enough room to store it." Let us therefore open the floodgates of heaven with our giving, with the overflow of our hearts, and with the promise of a more than enough abundance. Today, I humbly ask you to join us on this noble journey. Your contributions will enable us to continue this vital work, to reach even further, to serve more, and to manifest the heavenly realities around the world. As you open your hearts and your hands in generosity, may you be blessed abundantly, not just in material wealth, but in the riches of glory, in the joy of giving, and in the knowledge that you have co-created in the building of the kingdom of heaven on earth. As our Jewish sages taught, tithing is the holiness available below. And as our Master Jesus the Christ proclaimed, "Give, and it will be given back to you, good measurements that overflow." Together, let us be the agents of change that our world so desperately needs. Together, let us be the vessels of prosperity that bring forth the heavenly realities. Together, let us make miracles happen. Thank you from the depths of my heart for your unwavering support and your boundless generosity. May the fruitful abundance of heaven overflow in your life. God bless you. Amen. Thank you.